April 6th. No, today is April 4th, 2006. This is Sammie Morris, archivist for Purdue University Libraries, and I'm here today with Barbara Cook, Betty Nelson, and Katherine Markee, and we're interviewing Barbara Cook for our oral history program. Hello, Barbara. Thank you for agreeing to be interviewed today.
Hello, Sammie. I'm glad that you all are here.
Thank you for having me in your home today. Could you start off by telling us when and where you were born?
I was born December 8, 1929 in Memphis, Tennessee.
And when did you move to this area?
I moved to this area in 1956.
Okay. So did you go to school in Tennessee, or?
No, I went to, I did my bachelor's work at the University of Arkansas.
Okay.
I was there from 47 to 51.
And what did you major in there?
I majored in sociology. And I know this might not be on your list of questions, but you wanted to know how I got to Purdue, and this is where the story begins. So may I kind of?
Absolutely.
All right. Well, I was a sociology major. I was active on campus. I lived in residence hall, and I got to know the director of residence halls real well, who was somebody named Beverly Stone, and the dean of students was named Jeanette Scudder. Jeanette Scudder happened to have been a graduate of Purdue University. At that point, I didn't know anything about Purdue, but when I graduated from college, I wanted to work for the Southern Regional Conference. This was in 51 when segregation was a very serious problem in the South, and I really wanted to work with helping integration in the South and to see if there were ways that could be handled by states or regional areas. And the two schools that offered some instruction in those areas were Duke and the University of North Carolina. So I thought I would apply to the University of North Carolina because I thought it'd be less expensive than Duke. And I went and talked to my major professor, who I was very close to. I babysat his children. I was a good student in sociology. I helped him get the Sociology Honorary Society started at Arkansas. And I asked him if he would write me a recommendation, and he said, "No, I won't. I don't think women should go to graduate school. I think they should get married and have children." At which point I was stunned. I mean, I thought, why have I wasted all my time here if I can't do anything with it? I really was saddened by that response, and I didn't know what I was going to do. But I thought, well, I'll go back to Tennessee and I will get involved with the social work, the Department of Social Work, and perhaps they would give me a job. And I had to take a test, which I did. And while waiting for the results of the test, I got a call from Jeanette Scudder, who was a dean of women I had graduated at this point at Arkansas, and she said, "Would you be willing to come and accept a job for about 6 weeks?" And I said, "Yes." Yeah, I was delighted. I mean, I loved Arkansas. It was I was a place I could go back and I would be paid, and I wasn't sure I'd ever get a job doing anything.
University of Arkansas.
Yeah, University of Arkansas. Well, when I got there, I apparently Beverly Stone, who had been the director director of residence halls had been called back to duty. She had been in the Navy in World War II, and she was called back for some duty for a period of 6 weeks or so, maybe 12 weeks. And they needed somebody in the residence halls, and so Jeanette Scudder, who must have been really hard up, called me and asked me to do it. So I did go back there, and I worked there that summer doing whatever Jeanette told me to do. And I enjoyed it very much. I didn't know what I was doing half the time, but I learned a lot. And then at the end of that period, Jeanette called me in and said that Beverly was returning back to Arkansas, but she, Jeanette, wanted to go study a little bit more at Columbia University. And would I consider working in the residence halls for the next year? So I said, yes, it was wonderful. I mean, I was having a wonderful time. I had friends there, and it was great. So I worked in the freshman residence hall, not knowing what in the world I was doing, but and when Beverly came back to campus, Beverly Stone, she lived in the apartment right across from where I did in a residence hall, which were both lovely apartments. And we got to be very good friends. Not only that, she told me what to do, so that helped. But anyway, I stayed there all that academic year, and I guess I didn't do anything too bad, I can just remember silly things like once I thought we needed more sheets in the hall, and I called the department, and the man there said, do you realize that every time a sheet is washed, you use 2% tensile strength? And I said, oh. I said, well, they ought to last a long time then. Well, he didn't think that was funny, but I guess we got our new sheets. I don't remember how that turned out, but anyway.
About what year was that you were there?
I was there from 51 to 52.
Were you the resident advisor? Was that your title?
Well, I don't know what my title was. I was sitting in the office where the residence hall director ran it, but I never considered myself director of anything, but I guess I did okay. Anyway, I enjoyed it, and I liked the kids, and we had a pretty good time. Or I had a pretty good time. I didn't get fired anyway, so I guess that was good. Well, at the end of that period, when Bev came back and Jeanette left, before Jeanette left, she asked me what I really wanted to do with my life. And I said, well, I really like what I'm doing. And she said, well, you need to get some graduate work, and you should go to, well, she mentioned Teachers College at Columbia or Syracuse University. And I chose Syracuse because they paid room, board, and tuition if you were accepted for their program. They gave those, they were called student dean programs. And I think it was a two-year program. And I think there were about 18 in a class. But Jeanette wrote a nice reference, and I was accepted. And so that's what I did. I went to Syracuse then and studied for two years.
Is this your master's degree that you got?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, master's degree. I don't know how much detail you want out of all this.
As much detail as possible. Well, I just was going to say, for the record, if you could just say the date you got the year you graduated from there.
Okay, I will. Well, I went there in the fall of 52. I graduated in 54. But when I got there, this was kind of funny. I had always lived in the South. I had never been east. And Syracuse University is way far north and cold. So I had to kind of adjust to that. But the first, we were all assigned, the student needs were all assigned residence units. And most of them were little cottages, kind of like our co-ops at Purdue. But the, my first assignment was in Sims Hall, which was a real old residence hall. And I think it was about three stories high, and it had four units in it, and I was in one of the units, and I had about 20 students, I think. And my room was about as big as that wall over there, on the fireplace. It had room. It wasn't long. It were really narrow, and it had room for one bed, and I had one desk, a little desk, and a chair, and I could barely get from the chair to the bed. It was, you know, and that was it. But anyway, and also, the other experience I had then, which was really very good for me, Syracuse had a high Jewish population, and I had never really known much about the Jewish religion. And I had, as I said, about 20 students. One of the students was a black student, and I had never had a black student in a housing. So this was a really a remarkable cultural change for me, but it was not one I didn't welcome. I thought that was great. But I did make one terrible mistake. Right in December, at one point, I said, oh, it's Christmas. We ought to have a Christmas tree. And then I realized what I said. I was mortified. And the students all laughed. They thought that was really funny. Let's do have a Christmas tree. We've never had a Christmas tree. And so
that's great.
They all made funny things. We put it on. We had a wonderful time, but I was embarrassed about that. But anyway, I got through that year okay. And then the second year, all the student deans got together, and this was kind of a ritual at Syracuse. They told you where your assignment was going to be for the next year, and that was always kind of, you know, you were always worried about where you were going to be. And I was the last one to be assigned, and I was assigned to Blackwell Cottage, which I'd never heard of. It was the newest cottage they had. They had just bought the property. It was a beautiful old home. And was right across from the nice, wonderful park. It was just right across the street from that. Well, so that's where I went. And it's a little bit far from the campus, I might add, but other than that. And I had a whole group of new students at this time. And they were, because I guess because I had the last house, I got the last group of students who ever applied to Syracuse. They had all transferred at least twice before. They're the most unlikely scholars I have ever seen, but they were wonderful, fun-loving students. And the first week they were there, This house was really located. It was a beautiful house. It had pretty trees around it and so on. And I was looking out the back window, and I said just calmly, it was on a Sunday afternoon, I said, oh, you know, that'd be a good tree to climb. And they said, all of these students were mostly from New York State. And they said, oh, we've never climbed a tree before. Let's all go climb a tree. So we did. We were all up in this tree, all of us, the whole house and me. And I looked down, and here came Dean Hilton, who was head of the program, with her dog. And so I said to the students, shh, don't say anything. Well, of course, that made them laugh, and so they got uproarious for that. And I told Dean Sleeman, I said, I beg not Dean, I said, Dean Helton, I'm sorry. None of these students had ever climbed a tree before. And so she said, so I said, well, will you come in the house and have a cup of tea, hoping she would go away? But she said, oh, yes. She was very nice about it. She didn't fire me, although we were, one of our thing conditions for our job was that we had to wear hose and heels everywhere. And I was in blue jeans and tennis shoes, I'm sure. But anyway, I didn't get fired. And she did come in, and she sat down with all the students. And they were very fun-loving students, very fun to be with. So, you know, we had a good time. But I'll never forget that. I thought, my gosh, the third day I'm here, on the second year I'm here, here I'm climbing trees with my students, and here comes the director of the program.
Well, I'm sure they loved it.
Anyway, that was fun.
So there weren't the residence halls weren't segregated there whenever you were there. It sounds like you said there was a black student.
There was a black student, although they were segregated by sex.
Okay.
They were all women.
That's interesting that it was open at that time.
Yeah, it is, really. There weren't a lot of black students on campus. This was a very nice young woman. We talked a lot about race relations and what we might do and so on. So that was an area that had always interested me a bit. Well, anyway, make a real long story short, I graduated in 54. And at that year, a group of students, some of the 2 year students who were interested in higher education, Dean Helton arranged for us to go to the National Dean's Association, which was in Washington. So we got in a car and we all drove down, and so that was my first introduction to the National Dean's Association, which was fun. Well, and I had a couple of offers at that meeting for jobs. One was in Florida and one was in Vanderbilt. And I was sort of interested in the Vanderbilt one. I did go to interview at Vanderbilt. And I like that. My father graduated from Vanderbilt. It's a lovely old campus and big magnolia trees, good food. And it made me feel like home a lot, I guess. But the dean of students there was this elderly woman, and she kept calling me darling, and I thought, I don't think that's going to work, although the setting was gorgeous. But anyway. But then Arkansas, University of Arkansas, Jeanette called and offered me another job there, so I went back there for another year, and at that point did direct the residence halls that I had pretended I was directing two years before that. So I worked for really 2 years between the time I was at Syracuse. I worked with Jeanette and Beverly Stone real well, and we were real good friends. So. And that last year I was there, I had someone I was fond of. We dated when I was an undergraduate, and he was still around, and we started dating some more, and we got engaged, and we finally decided to be married that year. And he had a job in Kalamazoo, Michigan, so we moved to Kalamazoo, Michigan. I'm sorry, this is so long. We haven't even gotten to Purdue yet. We moved to Kalamazoo, Michigan, and I tried to get a job. I really felt I was very highly educated and could do anything at that point. Well, there were a few jobs open, but At that time, people didn't want to hire anybody that was married because they thought you'd get pregnant and quit. And I didn't have much luck interviewing. And finally, Ernst & Ernst certified accountants hired me as their receptionist. And I had this awful southern accent, which I still have some of. And every time I picked up the phone and I'd say, you know, good morning, this is Ernst & Ernst, they would say, where in hell did Ernst & Ernst get you? I must have heard that 100 times. But anyway, I got along okay with them. But, and my husband was a salesman and he was gone a lot of time. So it worked out real well, except he had been a professional golfer and was liked to golf a lot, and one day it was real cold. He and his brother went out golfing, and he came back, and he just looked awful. And he had a heart attack, and so he was in the hospital for a while, and he couldn't work at his job, and I knew I wasn't making enough at my job to support him. Fortunately, we could get him in the Veterans Hospital since he had been a veteran in World War II. So he ended up in Ann Arbor at the Veterans Hospital. And I would go down and see him whenever I could get off, which was usually on the weekends. And finally, he was released from the hospital. The doctor told me that he had a condition which he probably would not recover from, and that he probably wouldn't live very long. And so we went back to Grand Rapids and stayed with his mother a while. And I knew I had to get a job somewhere that was fairly close to his family if I could. And I called Beverly Stone. Bev and I stayed together, kept up pretty well, and told her what had happened. And she had just taken a job at Purdue, accepted a job at Purdue, but wasn't coming for a month or so. And she said, when I was there, she said, understand there was a vacancy for another person. And she said, I'll talk to Dean Sleeman about that. I think Dean Sleeman was out of the country, but at any rate, I talked to Dean Hilton, who was my dean at Syracuse, and told her the circumstances, and she said she would do a recommendation for me. And Bev talked to Jeanette Scudder at Arkansas, and she did one for me, and Helen offered me a job to come to the House Mother's Training School, and I don't know what I was supposed to do there, but I can't remember what I was doing. I didn't know what I was doing there, but I stayed in the Kappa House, which was, nobody else was there except the House Mother and me, and during the House Mother's Training School. And Helen said, well, Helen left the message that if I did all right in the House Mother's Training School, she would see if she would put me on staff. So anyway, I had fun at the House Mother's Training School. These older women who wanted to be house mothers, and there were classes for them and how to serve at the table, and I mean, you know, it was really quite a program. I was impressed. And I had to make a speech one day, which, you know, I didn't know what I was talking about, but I got through that all right. And, we also had a placement center, and people came from all over the country to interview house mothers. And, well, at the end of 10 days, I guess, I must have passed whatever they wanted me to pass, and so they did offer me a job in the dean of women's office. And lived only about a week, and then he died. And so here I was on a campus where I didn't know anybody. I didn't know anything about the campus except the House Mother's Training School, which wasn't very typical. And I was in a new town, although Lois Wark, who was on a staff member of the Dean of Students' Office, or Dean of Women's Office, was wonderful to me, and you know, and everybody was, everybody on the staff, and so that's where I ended up, and where I have been for many years. Never would have gotten there if I hadn't had those Arkansas connections with Jeanette Scott and Beverly Stone. I'm sure. Yeah. I think I was a counselor in the Dean of Women's Office, and I did part-time work for women, and I was worked with the co-op houses, women's co-op houses, and then everybody and staff did, you know, things like give out emergency loans and some of that, and I did some counseling, but not a lot that first year. It was mostly working with students who wanted part-time work and with the co-op group.
Did you also was counseling part of your job?
It wasn't then. It wasn't later. We had a placement service for women at that time in our office, and there was a placement service for men downstairs, which that lasted quite a long time, actually. And Lois Wark and I were the ones who were working in placement for women, and we did work. I think I worked probably 3 or 4 years in that, at least in that area. I did other things. One of the other things I did was advise mortarboard. I was a mortarboard at Arkansas, and Helen asked me to work with Bev Stone in advising mortarboard, which I did. So that's how I got involved in that group. I learned every year a little bit more about what I should be doing and what was needed to be doing, and I think it's my own confidence got better. Helen Sleeman let me do more things. We finally were, we also did summer placement for students, and I did quite a lot of that. We wrote places where students had worked previously in the summer, you know, things like old camps or conventions, we had a whole list of places where students might apply, and so we had information on all that. We kept that up, and then I worked with placement service for women, which took quite a lot of time. Lois and I worked, but I think Lois worked with me probably for around 3 years, and then she was married, and I think she had it, got pregnant and wanted to quit for a while. So, and then the placement service was shifted over to Stewart Center, which became a university placement center. So we got out of that. We got out of that business, and so from then on, I did really a lot of counseling, and we all work with student organizations and housing units, and you know, whatever whatever the dean asks us to do. So, you know, I don't remember that year. Probably, I think it was maybe 4 years after I got there, 4 or 5 years. Yeah, it probably was. Or, yeah. What are we starting with? When I first got there, first of all, it was much smaller. I don't know how many students we had. I can't remember, but it, well, I remember this much, that we knew, somebody, the dean of women's office, knew every student by name on campus, so it was that small. Oh, it was 5-6 to 1, something like that. There's a wonderful Purdue song that says, you know, oh Purdue, where your men are many and your girls so few, very few at Purdue. But, they wore pots. Everybody wore pots for some reason. I mean, whatever they were in, if they were in an organization, they had their little hat, which they all called pots.
How do you spell it?
P-O-T-S, pots.
But it looked like a beanie.
Yeah,
okay.
Actually like a beanie. And if you were a freshman, you had to wear a, you know, a freshman hat. And there were cards. Do you know about the cards?
I've heard,
Purdue cards. Well, these were corduroy pants for the men. Well, only seniors had. And corduroy skirts for the women, and they painted all over them their, you know, whatever clubs they were involved in, their school, their classification, their major. I suppose their love life, the freshmen all used to try and steal the senior cards, and you know, I mean, it was fun. I mean, it was a lot of fun. They had a lot of fun doing all these crazy things. But all the organizations at Purdue had pots. They all had something. If you were in Gold Peppers, you had a little gold thing. If you were in whatever, it was another color, and you know, and which was kind of new to me. I had never seen so many pots in my life on top of people's heads. And that lasted, I think about 6 years or so, and then the whole student body sort of changed, and they got rid of senior cards. You know, it was a great tradition, really. It was fun. I think they all had a great time. Well, I didn't come around till about 68, 69, so that was a little later. At this time, it was just, they're just nice, wholesome students that had fun, I think, and you know, we didn't have any problems then. It was all, everybody was well-behaved, and, you know, thought Purdue was wonderful, and it was just a different time, but It was the Vietnam War that created all the problems for us, or many of the problems for us.
How did that challenge you in your position?
Well, it was a hard time, I think, for all of us. I think there were a lot of things happening at the same time. When the Vietnam War came about, college students were eligible for the draft, and so a lot of college students were drafted and went off to the war. And I think that was a real fear that many students had, and they didn't want to go to the war, and they didn't want to be drafted, and they didn't want to fight in Vietnam, and there was a lot of anger over that, and many people didn't like the Vietnam War anyway, and also, at that point, the university was kind of conservative, I think, and what its expectation of students were. And the students felt maybe as a result of knowing they might have to go to war, but they felt that the university was too paternal. They felt they didn't have enough say-so about the university policies, that nobody paid any attention to them. And a lot of buildup, that the regulations were too strict, the women had to be in at a certain hour, there were a lot of rules that, it was just kind of a general rebellion that happened on many campuses in the country. We happened to have an editor, the exponent, who was a very liberal young man, very bright, but who wrote all kinds of bad things about Purdue and what was going on and the university president and they started using kind of smutty words, and you know, it got really kind of. And there were lots of rallies on the Oval and wherever. And one of my jobs was to attend the rallies in that three-year period or so. So every day I was out there with L. Roark, who was on the Dean of Men's staff, or Jim Scott, who was there. The two of us were always out there. We weren't there to apprehend the students. That wasn't why we were there. We were there to make sure that there wasn't a lot of serious trouble. And we also didn't want the police to be manhandling our students. And so we were just kind of there to observe. And I think we were there so much they didn't know who we were. We were part of them. Gang leaders or what, but you know, I can remember walking to the courthouse with the students and walking to the airport over some rally that was going on, and we had a little destruction out of that. I think you'd walk in your office and there'd be a note under your door saying, we know how to get in here, and we know where your furnace is in this building, and I mean, you know, just stuff. But I mean, that never happened. It just was, they were just kind of threats, but kept you off guard a lot, off balance.
Did the students ever come to you personally or in groups to complain about things?
We did a lot of work with students. We worked with student organizations that had worked with us, and there, not all the students were rebelling, you know, but the ones that were pretty verbal, and they had pretty good group, but the, but the war, it was interesting. The war displays got involved with the university, things they wanted done at the university, too. It wasn't always clear-cut. For example, there was a time when the university wanted to raise tuition, and there was a big student upheaval over that. These kinds of concerns that student had kind of melded together, and sometimes they were on top and sometimes they were on the bottom, and so you never were quite sure what was going on. The black students at that time became agitated about the treatment they were getting at Purdue, and they were a very verbal group. Now, I don't think they were necessarily involved with the Vietnam, but you know, everybody was rioting, so if you had anything you wanted to complain about, you know, you could find a lot of people to help you, probably. So it was a difficult time, really. And I think the university learned a lot from that. I think instead of being so so rigid, and instead of thinking that only faculty or administrators could make room, or to stop thinking that students couldn't think for themselves, or couldn't set up an environment that would be healthy, it was. And I think really the Dean of Women and Dean of Men did a good job in this period. I think we probably understood the students better than most of the administration. And a good many of the faculty as well, although some of the faculty were also instigating a little of the riots, so I mean, they weren't. And there were moderate students on campus who tried to keep this down. But students at that period did some really good things. They set up the Student Bill of Rights, which was very well thought out and well done. They set up there were several other things that had really significance for the life of the student body, I think. And students began to work with faculty committees on the appeals procedure is what I'm trying to think of in disciplinary proceedings, and the Bill of Rights, though, was a very strong statement that showed what the university expectation was, but they also had ways for appealing decisions made by administrators, which was a good thing. They wanted to have a system where they could grade their own professors, and finally this came about too. Now, I think on many parts of the campus you can check, and I think this is widely used, where you check whether you liked your professor, and on a series of things, you know, was it well organized? Yeah, evaluations. So all of that came in. So there were some really good things that came in, and I think it really resulted when it was all over, which we thought it would never end, of course, but when it was all over, I think there was a lot more respect on the part of some of the administration for students, and vice versa, and that students became more involved in university decisions. which they should be in my judgment. So. But it was an interesting period.
Don't ask me.
I don't know. Well, I was there for a long time, I guess.
Was it still dated when you took the position?
It was Dean of Women. It was Dean of Women until Helen resigned. Eddie? No. Okay. There was a dean of men and a dean of women's office, and Helen was a dean of women, and Bev was associate dean, and I think I was assistant dean, and Betty probably was assistant dean. We had a whole lot of assistant deans, as I recall. I don't know what our titles were exactly, but something like that. And then when Helen left, there was a dean of men and a dean of women, and when Helen left as dean of women, at the same time, or round about the same time, the dean of men had, the man who was dean of men at that point also left. And so I think Bill Fishing was vice president then. Yeah, O.D. Yeah, O.D. Roberts was dean of men when Helen was dean of women, and he resigned, and then Brian Clemens came and stayed a couple of years, and then he resigned, or was fired, or something. I won't say that. And I think Bill Fishing was there then. Bill Fishing was the vice president of student services then, and he decided that we should have one office of dean of students, and that's what happened. And Bev was appointed dean of students, the first woman dean in Indiana, I guess, dean of women, dean of students, first dean of students in the Big Ten, actually, I think. She was thinking about going to a college in the South. I can't remember which one it was, Holyoke or somewhere like that. And I don't think she was sure she wanted all that responsibility. But I think Helen and all of us at New Bev persuaded her to stay, and I think she did a great job. I think she was really. We had to change. Everybody had their own forms. You know, the dean of men had their forms. We had our forms. We had committees. They had committees. They didn't all, you know, weren't all the same. We all had to. We spent a lot of time reorganizing the whole thing, but I think it worked pretty well. Bev was a good administrator. She was a nice person and got along well with people, and I think you might not have liked having the offices merge, but you couldn't help but like Bev, so that helped a lot.
What were the particular challenges as a woman?
Well, I think there weren't many women in administrative positions at Purdue. I think Betty Sudarth was registrar, but that was a little later, wasn't it, Betty? We had a dean of home economics who was a woman. We had a department of physical education for women, which was a woman. The director of the residence halls was a man. But before that, I think Betty Arnsman was director of the women's halls, probably. But there weren't a lot of women administrators around, and that was kind of a remarkable thing that Purdue did. We all felt that they appointed a woman as dean of students. And, I think she did a very good job. Betty and I were you associate dean then, Betty? I think you were. Well, Celie Zissis was associate dean. I was associate dean. Maybe that was all.
What year did you become
dean?
1980.
Uh-huh.
What about the people you worked with back then? I'm just a little bit, you were mentioning Helen Schlinger. Tell us a little bit about her.
Oh, she was wonderful. Alan was was a Navy in World War, the captain in World War II, with Dorothy Stratton, who preceded her. And they were both in charge of, well, Dorothy was in charge of the spars, the women in the Coast Guard, and Helen was her first lieutenant. And Beverly Stone also had been in the Navy during World War II, so they were, it's kind of a Navy-related office. Well, it would have helped, probably. It didn't hurt, no. I wasn't in it. Betty wasn't in it. We were too young, I guess. That's right. Yeah, that's right. I was on the Salvation Army board. Well, they used to kid me about that. I think Helen was one of the smartest, nicest, fearless people I have ever known. She was very concerned about women. She was very concerned about women at Purdue. She was very concerned that they got raises. She was very concerned they got promoted. She did everything that she knew how to do that, and she was outspoken about it. She set up a committee on status of women. She and President Hovde were good friends, which helped. They both played golf and were both good golfers. But she got John Hicks to chair this, and it was a very good committee set up of women who really studied the salaries of women, which were all of them were lower than men. The promotions, women weren't promoted as soon as men were, and there were a lot of things that were not equal. Helen led the fight for that. She was great. Yeah.
I think I read somewhere that she had been one of the people who was responsible for getting the women's
Oh, yes, she was.
Do you remember that?
Oh, I do indeed. That's right. Helen and Beth both were rather adamant about this, but Helen, again, was leader in this. But she when she was in the Navy, they took care of women. Women could make their own decisions. Women were as good as men in doing this. I mean, they, you know, she felt very strongly about it, and she said it just didn't make any sense when you could let the men stay out all night and you had to get the women in and so on. Well, that was kind of a... I really don't know how this ever got through. I mean, I'm sure it would have 10 years later, but but AWS, the Associated Women Students, also wanted to get rid of the curfew. So you had a student group, probably influenced by Ellen, to take this stand. And, but Helen was, you know, there were trustees that were really ready to fire Helen over her insistence that this happened, and that, you know, there was all these comments about, well, we, you know, my mother won't send me to school if I have to, you know. Well, that never happened, of course. So, and, but she was great. She did more for women, I think, than anybody ever did on this campus, both women students and women staff and faculty and employers. I think she was so rational, and she was so nice, but she was determined. I mean, she was not striving, but she sure made sense in what she said, and it was pretty hard to argue with her.
She wasn't the hysterical female.
No, no, no.
Or the manly woman who was trying to be like a man, you know, all
yeah.
The stereotypes.
Now, no, she wasn't like that, but she was very determined, and she was very fearless. I mean, she didn't mind talking to the trustees or the president or the chairman of the board of trustees, or, and I think she was so well respected that, you know, I know President Hovde respected her, and I think that helped a lot. No, I mean yes. All universities had it.
Oh, I see.
And Purdue was the first institution in the Big Ten to do away with it.
Really?
And all of the deans of women from all over the Big Ten called and said, "Why did you do that? How did you do that?" Purdue was considered kind of conservative at that time, but
well, did women on the faculty get turned into? I don't
know. Do you, Betty?
I know you had talked earlier about how when you first started your career, it was hard as a married woman to get hired because there was somebody
yeah.
who could come
pregnant. That's right. Betty was hired. She was married. Yeah, I do too. I think there were some nepotism restrictions, but I think those were changed. And it was bad at a while. I remember when the Augurs were here, Marguerite and Victor Augur, who both had their degrees in history. PhDs, and Victor was hired, but Marguerite couldn't be hired because, well, you couldn't hire two of the same family in the same department, and I think there was some hesitation about hiring women who were married, that they would just get pregnant, and that would be the end of them, but I think that changed fairly. Helen Sleeman was the one that hired Pat's mother in the dean of women's office.
Yeah. they all connect somewhere. Well, tell me a little bit. I've heard that the mortar board chapter at Purdue has been really, it's really excelled compared to the other chapters around. Can you tell me a little bit about what you think makes, you know, this chapter so special and what you, how you're involved with it?
Well, I think the mortar board chapter here has always had good advisors. And they've been blessed because they came up with the idea of selling calendars, which gave them money to work with so they could do things that made a difference, like they give fellowships, have given fellowships out. They gave beginning scholarships to women, particularly in the science fields like engineering, physics, chemistry, things of that sort, so that maybe they could be to give them more support, because there were a lot of scholarships that were only available for men. I think they've had money that they could use to good advantage, and I think they've done that wisely. And I think they've had good advisors over the years. Usually the chapter has three advisors, and they do kind of different things, but they get a lot of faculty support, and I think the dean of students' office and dean of women's office always offered them good support. So,
well, yeah.
Oh, I can
get it on the record. Tell me about your role. I think you talk about some of your accomplishments in that group.
Well, I don't think my accomplishments were any greater than anybody else's. I just stayed there longer, I think. Honestly, I really mean that. I think Bev Stone was one.
Beginning of tape 2 of the interview with Barbara Cook, April 4th, 2006, in her home.
Barbara, we talked a little bit about the memories of Helen Schliemann. Did you also know Dorothy Stratton? Did you talk about her?
Yes, I think all of us did in the office sooner or later, but as I said, she was head of the spires during World War II, and after that, she did a number of things. She worked for the International Monetary Fund. She was worked with AAUW in their overseas projects. I know some. I can't remember. The Girl Scout. Oh, she was executive director of the Girl Scouts for a while. She retired and lived in Poverty Holler Road in Connecticut, right? Connecticut. I'm sorry, I couldn't remember that. I was trying to think of that nice nursery there that he found. Dorothy grew up in Kansas. She was a daughter of a Baptist minister, and they moved from town to town as they did in those days. And I once asked Dorothy what she did as a child. She was always very studious, and she said she usually just went to the library and read books, and I could see her doing that, but she was a good, she was studious, she read everything, York Times from cover to cover, and she read books, and she did her PhD. I'm not sure where she finished. I know she studied at Kansas, University of Kansas, University of Chicago, and Teachers College. So I don't know. I'm not sure where she got her degree. No, she wasn't an only child. She had one brother, and she has niece and nephew, and some great nieces and nephews. And she just had her 107th birthday. Betty and I attended the birthday party, and she's not very well, but she certainly knows what seems to know what's going on. She was the first full-time dean of women at Purdue. She was hired by Edward Elliott, and she hired Helen, or I think she hired Helen, not on her staff, but hired Helen. Well, I guess Helen was hired in the residence halls to be head of the residence halls, and that's how they got together. So, well, they knew each other in the Navy too, of course. So, kind of interesting thing about the women in the Navy, I think, or the Air Force, or World War II, was when they were looking for heads of these women's services, like the Navy and the Army, the Air Force, Marines, whatever. They looked at universities, women in administrative positions in universities, to try to get them interested in those jobs, because they felt they knew how to manage women and, you know, so on. So that was kind of interesting, yeah.
Well, what would you say, Barbara, is your proudest moment or your finest achievement?
I suppose being made dean of students was. I certainly don't think I expected that, and I was very pleased to try and do that.
That's enough, then. Okay. One final question for you. If you could give women students some advice today, what would it be? Just thinking back on your own career, and what would you tell women students?
What was that comment that somebody made, which said, be a man, be a man, my friend. Be a man, Miss Shoemaker, yeah, be a man. Well, I think women should be proud of themselves. I think they should know they have the same abilities as men. I think they shouldn't let men push them around. I think they should care for one another, and I think they should have human concerns for everybody. But don't let people step on you. You know, I think women make a wonderful contribution to this world, and we need them, and we need them to feel good about themselves. So, that's right. That's my speech.
Sure, some of that, and it continues, but
entering.
Well, I think my whole experience involved around mentoring. I mean, I think I had mentoring from Bev Stone and the residence halls, from Jeanette Scudder, who really taught me a whole lot. I certainly had it at Syracuse. I've certainly had it at Purdue. Helen was a wonderful mentor, and the staff and the dean of the women's office. And I think they let us do things. They gave us opportunities to do things. They tried to get us interested in professional organizations. They let us go to conferences outside of the state and the rest of the country. And they were good people to look up to. They were good people that you cared about, and they cared about you, and you knew that. It was a wonderful, wonderful place to work, really. But they did that very well, mentoring. They gave you every opportunity they could, and both Helen and Bev did that. And I think Betty did that too. I'm sure she did. I never was there when Betty was there, but as dean, but I think she probably made a pretty good dean, I guess. Well, I'm not sure.
Well, I've always been struck by how easy you are to talk to, almost like someone that, you know, we've known forever, and I think it makes sense to me now because of your background in sociology, and, you know, that just sort of gels with your personality to me. I just want to say on the record that it's been a pleasure to interview you as our first person to interview for our new oral history project. And we are going to try to focus more on women's histories at Purdue, and yours is a very important voice and an important contribution. I did think of one last question, which I forgot to ask, if you won't mind. I wanted to ask you about Title IX and how... you know, how that affected your job whenever that came about at Purdue.
Title IX. Well, I think Title IX was one thing that most of us were for. It affected some things, like it affected mortarboard, since you talked about mortarboard. Mortarboard had been only a women's organization to that time, and now it's co-ed, and that makes a difference in the way the group runs, but nonetheless, it's continued and it's done well, so I think Title IX was very important for women. I think it meant that you had to give them equal salaries, and you should give them equal opportunity, and it gave our women students chances that they never had before in athletics. Well, when I was first at Purdue, in fact, for a long time when I was at Purdue, only men could usher in the Hall of Music, for example. And there were lots of things like that that just didn't make any sense. I'm really surprised Title IX ever got passed, but I think we had to have it. It just made sense.
What were some of the concerns about having men join the board?
Well, actually, I think once Title IX passed, we realized that we could ask for favors if we weren't doing the same, if we weren't giving some favors. And I think the difference is made in the group. The group is a lot larger now, and I think that's partly national. You probably need some money, but it seems to me it gets along just as well as it did, except there's so many of them in the group now, I never know their names, but other than that, I think it's, they seem to be functioning well. Well, our last 2 years we've had women as presidents. We had at least two or three men who have been president and have been very good presidents. In fact, Rusty Ruth, you know, who gave the money to, he was president of Waterboard. He was a good president. He was, I think he was the first committee. And he was good. So, well, they're not quite alike, but they're almost, men and women are pretty much alike in personality. So, I think the men have enjoyed being in it, and I think the women have enjoyed having them, so, and I think it only makes sense. Probably old women and mortar board that don't think men should be there either. I don't know.